This is the isomerization process. Okay, in the refining industry, isomerization process, C4 isomerization process. In the refining industry, normal butane versus isobutane, which one do you think is a more valuable feedstock? Why isobutane is a more valuable feedstock? Branched chains are preferred because branched chains can be used, they can do a lot of chemistry, okay, and branch chains, when you add to petrol, octane number goes up, right. So between NC4 and IC4, IC4 is preferred, okay, IC4 is more valuable. IC4 meaning isobutane, normal butane, isobutane, okay. So you have a process which is basically isomerizing A to B, NC4 to IC4, okay. And now what we have is the process looks something like this. You got a very tall tower, okay, we will make it, and then maybe if we have to redraw, we will redraw it. So there is a deisobutanizer. It is a tall tower. You see, IC4 and NC4 will be close boiling because they are isomers, the boiling points will be very close, okay. So if you separate it using distillation, since the boiling points are not very different, you will get a very tall tower. Relative volatility is close to 1, maybe 1.05, maybe 1.1. So you will get a very tall tower to separate NC4 from IC4. Okay? So you take a stream which is the feed stream, and the feed stream has got what? It has got some amount of propane, small amount of propane, it has got the C4s. It has also got some amount of C5, okay. This is a feed stream coming from upstream. Isopropane is lighter than N-propane, okay. Isobutane is lighter than N-butane. So you take out this is IC4. Comes out the top, this is your product. Any C3 that is coming in the feed is bound to end up at the top because C3 is lighter than C4. Yeah. NC4 and C5s with small amount of IC4 leaking down the bottoms, and that small amount, you see, if the separation is easy, the small amount may be 0.1%. Since here the separation is difficult, this small amount could be 5%, even 10%. Okay, so whatever C4 is coming in, whatever IC4 is coming in, 90% of it goes up, 10% of it leaks down. Okay, so the recovery in the bottoms or loss in the bottoms is 10%. If the separation was easier, this recovery could have been less than 1%, but here the separation is difficult, so you will not have very impressive small numbers for leakage down the bottom, okay. Now this NC4 rich stream is taken to what? A purge column. What does the purge column do? The purge column is a small tower. What it does is takes out the C4s up the top, C4s go up the top, the C5s go down the bottoms. C5 purge. ओके, द सी फोर्स आर नाउ सेंट टू अ रिएक्टर आफ्टर प्री हीटिंग, प्री हीटिंग इन अ हीटर और अ फर्नेस, आई डोंट नो. ओके, सो व्हाट यू डू इज यू टेक दिस सी फोर स्ट्रीम, यू टेक दिस सी फोर स्ट्रीम send it through a feed effluent heat exchanger, then send it through maybe a furnace or maybe a heater, that depends on what the reaction temperature is. If the reaction temperature is above say 250 degrees Celsius, you will have to have a either a Dauthum based heater. If it's less than 250 degrees Celsius, you can use high pressure steam. If it's above 350 degrees Celsius, you'll probably be using a furnace. Okay, so I am just maybe making a furnace. Okay, the furnace is doing what? Is heating the reactor to is heating the reactor feed stream to its inlet temperature. The reactor feed stream is then sent to what? A packed bed reactor, which is adiabatic. What do you mean by adiabatic? Neither heated nor cooled. Okay. All right. No heating, no cooling. It goes to this reactor. In the reactor, NC4 reacts to give IC4. So this is the heating stream. So I take this, take it down. Okay, so the cooled reactor effluent is further cooled and condensed in a condenser. This stream, the outlet from the condenser, is liquid. What do you think would the composition of this stream be compared to the feed in terms of NC4 and IC4? Let us say the fresh feed, which is this guy. Let us say it is 70% NC4, 25% IC4, and the rest is C3 and C5. Okay, 5% is C3 and C5. What do you think the composition of this stream would be? What is coming out the condenser? So the feed stream is rich in NC4. What would the composition of the stream coming out of the reactor be? It would be rich in what? NC4 or IC4? Given that it is richer in IC4, given that IC4 is what is being recovered in the deisobutanizer as a distillate, where should I be feeding it? Should I mix it with the feed stream? You see, I could do this. I am just, you know, talking for the heck of it. I could do this, just mix it and send it to the deisobutanizer. Is that a good idea or is that not a good idea? Why is it not a good idea? Yeah, so but I need to recover it. I have converted NC4 to IC4. Some NC4 is still remaining. I want to recover IC4. And now my question is, what is the best place to feed it in the deisobutanizer? This is the deisobutanizer, deisobutanizer, okay, and this is the purge column, purge, okay. So where should I be feeding it? Is this okay?
Above.
Why above?
It is lighter, more heavy.
Exactly, exactly. That's all that I was asking. Where above? Sure, you need to do an analysis. Okay, what is the best location? But at least this much should be clear, that if I am mixing it with the fresh feed, I am doing something dead wrong. Yeah? Okay. So this is probably fed someplace here, maybe. Okay. does the process look okay? What is the steady state operating degrees of freedom?
7.
How is it 7?
2 plus 2
is. Oh well, of course, 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 done 7 times is also 7. Please give me an explanation. 2 for the first column, 2 for the second column, 1 for the furnace, 1 for the condenser, the cooler, you know, the this chap, and 1 for the fresh feed.
One reactor.
Well, furnace is, reactor is adiabatic. See, that's why I asked the question. Reactor is adiabatic, there is no cooling. So, the only thing you can set is how much heat you are putting in the furnace, so that what is the temperature of whatever is going into the reactor. Right? So, does that make sense or no? So, that's that 1 degree of freedom that you have. What is the temperature of the feed going into the reactor? Once it goes into the reactor, as much reaction as has to happen happens, and then the temperature rises a little bit. Okay, and then the exit temperature is whatever it is. It's not a degree of freedom because that's not in your hands. Once you have set the reactor feed temperature, basically the outlet is fixed. Well, I need to qualify that. Once you have set what's going into the reactor, that means what is the composition, what is the temperature, what is the flow rate. What comes out gets set. Yes or no? Temperature is getting set by the furnace. Flow rate and composition are getting set by what you are feeding, how you are separating, etc., etc. Right? So, what is flowing into the reactor is set by whatever is the fresh feed, its composition, that's given. Then, how much of whatever you are feeding goes up the top, how much of it goes down the bottom. Then in the second column, how much you take down the bottom and therefore what goes up the top, that sets the flow rate, right? What sets the temperature of this guy? What sets the temperature of this chap? The cold feed to the reactor, to the reaction section. What sets the temperature? Dew point of the vapor at the column pressure. At the purge column pressure, what is the dew point of the vapor that's coming in the purge column? What sets the composition is basically how much you are removing, that sets the composition in the flow. Furnace has been installed so that you can have what is going into the reactor at whatever temperature you desire. Yeah, that's the degree of freedom for the furnace. So 2 degrees of freedom for the column, the deisobutanizer, 2 degrees of freedom for the purge column, 1 for the furnace, 1 for the cooler and 1 for the fresh feed. So, 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 1, that's 7. Yeah. Now, I start asking you questions.
Sir, why I am taking for cooler?
What does the cooler do?
Sir, vapor cool down
and then it should do what?
Into liquid.
Exactly. And that liquid gets set by what? Whether it will liquefy or not, you have to be in the two-phase region or in the subcooled region. Right? And then you have to remove as much heat as is necessary to condense it out. If you are removing less than that, it will not condense. So, the need for condensation sets how much heat you need to remove. Yes or no? Okay. Therefore, you may decide not to count it by saying that look, the temperature is reasonable and it is dictated by the vapor liquid equilibrium. Okay. Just like you ignore the pressure inside a distillation column, you could ignore this too by saying that this temperature is something. something reasonable that will ensure that whatever is coming out the reactor condenses and liquefies. Yeah, then you can discount it. Agreed. Okay, so if I am counting it, then my specification will be what should the cooling duty be so that my temperature is, I don't know what, maybe 90 degrees Fahrenheit, 40-50 degrees Celsius, right? Fair enough. So I have counted it, and then I have accounted it as a set point or a temperature of the condenser outlet. So the condenser duty is being set by the requirement of having the condenser outlet at, I don't know, 40 degrees, 50 degrees. Okay, so I have counted it and I'll account for it this way. Before I start drawing control system around it, let us say I have designed this process to process some fresh feed rate, let's say 100 kilomoles per hour of fresh feed. Okay, I have designed this process for that, and now I want to run it in the most efficient possible way. Okay, so my fresh feed rate is given, that takes care of 1 degree of freedom. I counted 7, 1 degree of freedom gets taken care of, my fresh feed rate is given. We just argued that the temperature at the outlet of the cooler should be reasonable so that everything condenses, right? As long as it is reasonable, it will not have much of a role to play in terms of optimal operation. Yeah, so that takes care of 2. So what I am saying is, okay, let me just write it here, what's given and what's accounted for and what needs to be. So FC4 is given, fresh C4 that's coming in is given. Okay, temperature of the cooler is set at a reasonable value. So out of the 7, 2 are taken care of. Now I'm left with 5 degrees of freedom. What are they? 2 separations in the column, 2 plus 2, 4, and inlet temperature of the reactor. Reactor inlet temperature. These are the 5 degrees of freedom that are left, steady state. Okay. Control system will come to later. First, let us just understand how do I adjust these 5 degrees of freedom so that my operation is optimal. That is the question. Now think about it and tell me. So what I am saying is, temperature of the reactor, what should I do with that? Okay, what would be reasonable specs on DIB and purge columns? There are 2 specs on the deisobutanizer, there are 2 specs on the purge column. What would be reasonable values for them? What would be reasonable specification variables for them? What the hell is the rectifying section doing in the deisobutanizer?
No,
I want a specific answer. It is separating and understood. What is the light key and what is the heavy key in the deisobutanizer?
Light key C3 and IC4.
What is the definition of a light key and a heavy key? What does the rectifier do? A rectifier prevents the heavy key from leaking up the top. Anything lighter than the heavy key essentially goes up the top. Yeah. Okay. What does the heavy key do? What does the stripping section do? It prevents the light key component from leaking down the bottoms. Anything that's heavier than the light key essentially goes down the bottom. So the split is a light key heavy key split. Yeah. So what is the split in the deisobutanizer? IC4 NC4 is got nothing to do with C3. C3, any C3 is there, it's bound to go up the top because it's lighter than the light key. Yeah. Okay. So now I rephrase again the same question. What is the rectifying section in the deisobutanizer doing? It is preventing NC4 from leaking up the top. Okay. So a reasonable specification variable would be, what is the mole fraction of NC4 in the distillate of what? Diisobutanizer. Okay, that's one. What's the next specification? There are two specifications for the column, right? For the diisobutanizer column, we have specified what the rectification section of the DIB must do. What is the stripping section doing? Preventing IC4 from leaking down the bottoms. So I say X IC4 down the bottoms. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Similarly, two specs for the purge column. What are the rectifying and stripping sections in the purge column doing? The function that they are accomplishing.
In purge column, rectifying section preventing the NC4 and C5.
No.
NC4 only.
No.
Preventing C5 to go from top.
Preventing the C5 from going up the top. If there is any NC4, the whole idea of the process is all the NC4 must be converted. If I take, if I don't allow the NC4 to go up the top, nothing goes to the reactor.
So the normal methane also convert in isobutane.
Only if it goes to the reactor. If in the purge column I make sure that the NC4 doesn't go up the top, then what have I done? I have taken it all out down the bottoms. Right? So what is the rectifying section of the purge column doing? It is preventing C5 from leaking up the top. Okay. So I would say X C5, maybe we will call this D1 B1 first column, and we will call this D2 second column distillate. Yeah. And what is the stripping section doing?
Preventing
what? IC4 or NC4 or both? Key component will only be one, either this or that. NC4. Why?
Boiling point of IC4.
Yeah, because NC4 is the heavier one, and that's what I'm preventing from going down the bottoms. Anything lighter than NC4 is guaranteed to go up. Yeah. So X NC4 D2. Oh, sorry, B2. Sorry. Yeah, these are my seven specs. I just argued this is given, this is what basically it should be reasonable so that everything condenses. So I am not going to fuss about it. Okay. What about IC4? There must be some purity constraint on the IC4. Basically, I am saying this is a product purity spec. Okay, the amount of NC4 impurity in the IC4 must be below, let us say, I don't know, 2%, maybe 5%. Okay. So this is a product purity spec. I would not like to over purify. Yes or no? Why is that? Let us say my I want only 2%. Let's say my spec is that NC4 in the distillate should be less than 5%. Okay? Let us just say it is this. I can operate at exactly 5%, or I can also operate at 4% or maybe 3%. Right? Less than constraint is satisfied. Where would I operate? Obviously, you will say we'll operate at 5%. Yeah. Why? Extra purification is going to cost money.
It's not going to.
Well, something more than that, more important than that. Let us say you are allowing more NC4 to go up the top. The reason is, this is called the avoid product giveaway rule. If I am allowing my product to be over pure, that means impurity is less. If impurity was supposed to be 5%, let's say I'm having only 1% impurity. What that means is, the impurity doesn't fetch me anything, price, right? If I send maximum impurity that is allowed in the product, I am getting paid for the impurity. What am I getting paid for the impurity? I am getting paid the price of the product. Yes or no? Therefore, it is always economically optimal, 99% of the time, to basically have your product purity at the constraint and not over purify, because that allows you to sell something that's cheap for the price of something that's expensive. Yes or no? Basically, in not so simple terms, is cheating. Legal cheating.
But when we say that the purity of the product is 95%, then it is supposed that for that only we are getting paid. That is the specification of the product.
Yeah, but when I am saying, I guarantee you that it is octane number is 87, and let us say I am actually selling petrol that's 91 or 95 octane number. That means I am adding extra branched, right? But I am getting paid only for 87. What I am selling is 95 octane. I am adding extra additives. I am a fool. Yes or no? Every businessman knows this. Adulterate to the extent allowed. Yeah? Yes or no? That's what it is. So therefore, this, which is the quality spec on the product, must be at its constraint. You must allow maximum amount of NC4 to leak out, as much as is allowed, right? If it is 5%, 5%, if it is 2%, 2%, whatever. So we can't argue about this. So this is also set. Okay. Now we are left with what? Four things. I can clearly see that if I allow NC4 to leak down the bottoms in the purge stream, NC4, I was wanting to convert to IC4, NC4 has leaked out, that much less IC4 I generate, that will represent loss in revenue. So most certainly, this chap here, the mole fraction or the amount of NC4 leaking in the purge stream, in the C5 purge stream, must be kept small, right? We can argue how small, but nevertheless, it must be kept small. Okay. So let us say I keep it at, I don't know, maybe 5%. Why 5%? Because you may say 5% is large. I'm saying, well, C5 is anyway in small amounts in the feed stream. So let us say if you are putting in 100 kilomoles of the fresh feed, in that C5 will be 2 or 3 kilomoles. In 2 or 3 kilomoles of C5, if you allow 5% NC4 to go out, how much would that be?
And 0.04.
Something like that, right? Very small. So it is small. The point is, this purge stream flow rate is small, and so you can allow. I'm not going to fuss about it, is 5% okay or 10% okay. Basically, you have the awareness that you can't allow too much NC4 to leak down, right? And let us just say I'm saying 5% is what I call too much. Okay, so that takes care of this. Now I'm left with what? What should I do to the reactor temperature?
Should be some optimal value.
Should be some optimal value, of course.
If more temperature will lead to cracking of NC4.
Cracking, okay. So as high a temperature as possible. Okay, whatever that as high may be. Why as high?
Conversion.
Exactly. If the temperature is as high as possible, basically the recycle stream goes down. If conversion is as high as possible, unreacted NC4 is small. Unreacted NC4 is small means the NC4 recirculation in the recycle loop is small. If NC4 circulation rate in the recycle loop is small, essentially both the boil ups actually go down. The boil up in the diisobutanizer goes down, the boil up in the purge column also goes down. Okay, so T reactor should be max. Okay, now I am left with what? And this max could be, you know, people say that look, if you go beyond this temperature, like this fellow says, C4 starts to crack, or you know the maximum temperature allowed for this catalyst is this, beyond this temperature the catalyst starts to sinter, coke starts to deposit, it starts to lose activity, we have to shut down earlier and replace the catalyst, blah blah blah. There might be, you know, from processing constraints you will have do not operate the reactor beyond this temperature. Well, that temperature is what I operate at. Okay, so that's T reactor max. Okay, now I am left with two things. What are those two things? Those two things are these chaps. And what do they represent? XIC4 in B1 in the bottoms. Whatever is the IC4 that's leaking down the bottoms. And XC5 in the distillate from the purge column. Whatever is the C5 that's leaking out the top. Yeah. What does this represent? What do these things represent? These things represent the IC4 circulating round, inventory of IC4 circulating round, and in an inventory of C5 circulating around. Yeah? Yes or no? Okay. Now that I have said this, what do you think should be done with these two things? Can I say that okay, this should be max, min, this, that, etcetera, etcetera?
I think it should be min because we are wasting energy in circulating it and something
else. No, it's the other way around actually. If I see, okay, separation in the diisobutanizer is hard, right? So if I allow more IC5 to leak out, what happens? Boil up will go down, my steam consumption will go down. What is the problem with this? The problem with allowing more to leak out is whatever is leaking out, whatever IC4 is leaking out, in the purge column it has to be sent up. So, you have to boil it and send it up. So, the boil up in the DIB goes down, boil up in the purge column goes up. You can clearly see there is some optimum, you cannot really clearly tell which way, but I can most definitely tell because because the boil up in the DIB is going to be large because it is a tall tower, separation is harder. Most certainly I must ease out on this, this must be relaxed, not be too tight, right? Because the moment I start making it too tight, what will happen is the boil up in the diisobutanizer will shoot up exponentially. Yeah. What is that number, 5%, 10%, I do not know, but at least I know it cannot be too tight, it has to be on that side. Yes.
So, in the second the first column, why would increased IC4 increase the boil up? I mean, we are.
What is the state of the IC4 that is coming out here? It's liquid. Okay.
But sir, when we are ensuring that NC4 goes up the bottom, IC4 will automatically.
Yeah, but how does it go? It doesn't go automatically.
No, but if we are boiling, I mean, the energy required to boil that much amount of NC4.
Forget that. Let's say I got NC4 and IC4. Okay. NC4 is being boiled up. IC4 is lighter, IC4 is lighter than NC4. Okay. Now, let us say the for the same flow rate, well not for the same flow rate, let us say component flow rate of NC4 is fixed, component flow rate, IC4 component flow rate goes up, what will happen to the boil up? it will go up, right? You have to boil up, anyway you have to boil it, some energy will get taken for that. Yeah. However, because that separation is easier on the purge column, what I expect is, if I look at, for example, the boil up curve, if I look at the boil up curve and I am plotting x, okay, the bottom, in bottom one of IC4, right? IC4 was leaking down the bottom, right? I can clearly see that if I look at boil up total, that means the boil up in the first column and the boil up in the second column. If I look at these two things, total, sum it up. What I would probably find is a curve that looks something like this. You see, below this there is a sharp rise in boil up, because beyond this the rise in boil up is there, but it is not as sharp because the second column separation is much easier. I can, you know, this I can see qualitatively, right? So as long as I am somewhere here, I am okay. Do you see what I am saying? So I would say maybe 5 or 10% of IC4 leaking down the bottoms, right? 1% would be too tight, I will be somewhere here. Does that make sense or no? Huh? What exactly? I do not know. Reasonable value I can guess. Exact value I can get from an optimization like this, you know, exact value will be this guy where you have minimum. So this will have an optimum, this will also have an optimum, yeah, but the point is, just looking at the process, I have been able to figure out what I need to do with degrees of freedom, what are the reasonable things to do with, to manage my 7 degrees of freedom, yes or no? No mathematics, no nothing, just common sense, okay? Where do I need to apply some amount of analysis? Probably to figure out what to do with these last 2 remaining degrees of freedom, where I really do not know exactly what should be the set point so that my boil up is minimized, total boil up is minimized, total energy consumption for the same throughput is minimized. But I do know I can be near optimum by applying simple common sense, yes or no? Now that I know this, next class we will worry about maximizing throughput, okay? What do I do? So basically what I am saying is, I have got 2 unconstrained degrees of freedom for a given throughput. If I am wanting to allow the throughput to be maximized, that means throughput itself is a degree of freedom, then I have 3 unconstrained degrees of freedom. If 3 constraints become active, I would have lost all degrees of freedom and then my throughput is maximum. And once we have seen that, we'll implement a control system. Okay? All right.